everybody feels. My name is Kelly Ray Roberts, and we are in Portland, Oregon. We're in my beautiful new shared studio space that I share with three other artists. We call it the Soul Shine Studio. And you might know me from, let's see, I do lots of things, but I'm a painter. I'm a mixed media artist, and I license my imagery to companies who manufacture gift and home decor and stationery products that are sold in boutiques worldwide. And I wrote a book called Taking Flight, Inspiration and Techniques to Give Your Creative Spirit Wings. I'm also involved in a collaborative project called Hello Soul, Hello Business with my partner, Beth Nichols. What else do I do? I have a blog, I'm online, I have ebooks. I like to keep myself busy. Art and business is where my passion lives. My story is not uncommon. I never considered myself an artist. In fact, I had an older sister who is super creative, and somewhere in my brain, I told myself the story that there was only room for one artist in the family. And so as she was creating, I sort of went the academic route and went to college, decided to get my master's in social work, and created a whole career out of doing medical social work and worked a lot with patients and families in the ICU. Lots of death and dying, lots of heavy stuff. And then as I was approaching my 30th birthday, I had this itch to really answer the call that I was hearing and feeling within myself to make stuff. And one thing led to another, and before I knew it, I was painting and reading and teaching myself and taking workshops and started an Etsy shop in 2006. And that's when it occurred to me that, oh my gosh, I could perhaps do what I love and it could be financially sustainable for me. And one small, tiny micro step after the next, it worked out. So micro steps for me are just one tiny step after the next toward whatever vision we have for ourselves. And actually, on my website, I have a whole page dedicated to every small step I've ever taken toward this dream since 2006. And I have it there just to show people that I think so often we think of taking this big, giant leap. And when we think of taking the leap, we think that we're going down. We actually sort of visualize ourselves jumping off a cliff and going down. And I try to reframe that for myself and think of taking the leap as going, first of all, upward versus down and into flight, but also one tiny step at a time. So tiny step, opening up an Etsy shop. Next tiny step, maybe consider a newsletter. Next tiny step, sending an email to somebody that we admire. Like just these little tiny moves. They're so tiny, but what I believe happens is there's that famous quote about how once you start moving, Providence moves with you. And I really believe that I've witnessed it in my life, but I've witnessed it in so many others, where once it's not so much the physical motion of that tiny step, it's all the metaphysical stuff that happens when you put your energy in a forward motion. Doors open where you didn't think they would be opening. You meet people, they come into your life, their significance is huge. Things like that. Those are the micro steps, but they're actually quite big. You know, Taking Flight, I wrote that book, it's been 5 years, and to be totally honest, I wrote that book at my infancy. I wrote it, I opened up my little Etsy shop and started to believe in this little dream in 2006. I wrote that book 1 year later in 2007. So I think about that book now as it's just this beautiful time capture of somebody, and there's so many of us who are doing this, but it's this beautiful time capture of somebody who is really like at that edge and having a major pivotal moment in their lives of answering that call. And so I was like not an expert by any means. And I still don't consider myself an expert, but I really wrote that book because someone asked me to. An editor sent me an email, and she was seeing my journey sort of unfold as I started taking these small steps, and she thought it would be really useful to other people. And now, 5 years later, I'm so glad it's all been documented. If I wrote Taking Flight again, I would add so much. There's just so much juiciness that I know now that I didn't know then. And if I'm being quite honest, when I take a look at the book, I, in some parts of me, sort of cringe a little bit about how naive I was and how green I was. I was so green that I didn't even know the mountain that I was climbing. And in retrospect, I just want to reach out to that sweet 30-year-old girl and hug her because she was so oblivious. However, in a really important way, like kind of in a beginner's mind kind of way. And I actually try to get back to her as often as I can because that person isn't being very careful. They're not being very cautious. And I think the second we start to be careful and cautious, we start to censor ourselves a little bit, and we miss the real depth and juice of what we have to offer. But anyway, I would add how really hard it is to find our community, how hard it is to, once we do have momentum in our business, how hard it is to like choose what step to take next, because all of a sudden, all these opportunities come to you and you yourself start to embody this possibilitarian spirit. And so your brain starts, it's on overdrive of what is possible. And I have found that it is really hard to discern, do I do this? Do I do that? Do I go this direction? Do I go that direction? Nothing good or important or meaningful or amazing has come my way without the element of girlfriends and community and tribe. Hands down, it's been the most important element, second to my immediate family and the love that and the support that I have. But had it not been for connecting and really being intentional about finding that community of other people who are also having pivotal moments in their lives and also chasing their dreams and know what it's like, what you're up against and what you're celebrating, it's been incredibly important on a million levels. Also just the practical pieces too of, I know what that feels like. Have you tried this? Have you heard of this person or this resource? Or, you know, it feels like there's just orbits of people out there, and every once in a while we collide and it's kindred and sparks fly and inspiration hits and they're holding you. I feel really held by my community. I've had a few experiences in the last few years where I've met incredible people and then the world gets to see them in ways that I have seen them, and I feel like I'm going to jump out of my skin so excited for the gift that they bring to the world. I've had a couple experiences like that. One of them is with my friend Brené Brown, who I've known for many years, and when she sort of exploded onto the scene, not only was I crazy happy for her, but just really crazy happy for all the lives that were going to be touched because super important message that she has. I also had this experience a few years ago. I was sitting in the front row of two dear friends that were giving their first keynote, Andrea Shear and Jen Lemon. And as they were giving it, I could feel the energy. There were hundreds and hundreds of people behind me, and I could feel that they were getting their message as well. And I just wanted to like stand up and scream in the middle of this speech and be like, yes, yes, because we all have something to share and something really important to share. And I think it takes a lot of courage to share it, and it takes a lot of vulnerability to do that. I used to think before I got really brave with my life that success meant falling in line. It meant finishing high school, going to college, getting a degree, getting a job, paying my bills, buying a house, getting married, you know, sort of like falling in line. And That's what I thought growing up, but now I define it as, are we being brave with our lives? Whether that means we're an artist, we're not an artist, we're a parent, we're not a parent, whatever work we're doing, and maybe whatever work we're not doing, maybe just in our personal lives at home as parents, are we making brave choices? Are we listening to our whispers and the callings and the things that are sort of nudging on our hearts and our sleeves? Are we giving those things attention? That takes a lot of courage and a lot of bravery. And so I think that to me now is success. And as someone who has had a lot of commercial and financial, depending on how you look at it, success, I think I have learned that that is not the measure of success. I have one of my dear friends, Lacey. I asked her this question once, and her answer was brilliant. And she said that she defines success as, do you think your contribution is meaningful? Yes or no? And that's your answer. So I love that. And that's how I think of it now. This is what really concerns me about the topic of money and being an independent artist, is that I think people get caught up with, are caught up in, that the minute you start to make money, that you're no longer independent. Or that the minute you have sponsors or work with big manufacturing companies or publishing houses, that you're no longer independent and that you've sold out. And I just don't subscribe to that idea at all. I don't believe in the myth of being a starving artist. For me, I think partnering with sponsors or publishing companies or manufacturing companies is just a mechanism and a tool to reach a bigger audience. And I think that comes to, what are your values? And there's no wrong answer here. To, if you want to stay super small, then you stay super small. That's totally fine. If you want to like bring your message to a mass audience, then you do that. There's no shame in either of those scenarios. And I think it's a conversation we should be having. I have certainly had my fair share of commentary about selling out, mainly because I've chosen to bring my work to a large audience of people, and I'm glad that I have. People are surprised when I say that I have my fair share of critics. Every week I get a few emails or Facebook comments or blog comments that take little jabs at me for one reason or another. But the best advice I've ever been given about dealing with critics was from my friend Brené Brown. And she talks about this in her book, Daring Greatly, but essentially the idea is, unless that critic is in the arena with you, maybe they're not in the becoming an artist arena, but they have to be in the arena of, are they also pushing their edges? Are they also being brave with their lives, as we've been talking about quite a bit? Have they ever experienced what it's like to put your work and your life and your meaning in front of people? Unless they're doing those things, I don't listen to them. I don't hear them. I don't even think about them. Sometimes I will have friends of mine who in my community who are in, or they're, maybe they're writers or they're musicians or whatever, they know what it's like. I will call them and ask them, gosh, I'm feeling a little funny about this thing that someone said. And I want to know from you, is there any truth to that? Like, is there something here that I could be working on? I've done that many times, and there have been times when they're like, actually, yeah, there is this little like thing, and I'll take it. I'll receive it. I love hanging out with my neighbor moms. I love going on hikes with my family. My husband's an outdoorsy surfer, hiker, mountain climber kind of guy. So I love being adventurous with him. I love watching my toddler all day long. I could just watch him because I think they're so funny, hilarious, and interesting. I love making art. I love listening to good music. I love reading my books at nighttime. I love traveling on an airplane where nobody can talk to me or get to me or reach me and just sitting there in complete silence. It's like amazing.